I forgot what I'm doing for this. Jacksonville Water and Sewer Advisory Committee, please come to order. And thank everybody for coming tonight. We do have a few out. Let me find this here. Okay, I hope you all got your packets. I'd like to have a motion for the agenda. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion on it? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Raise your right hand. Okay. Thank you. Approval of the minutes for the March 12th, 2015. Do we have a motion for that?
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, do we have any discussion? Okay, all in favor, raise your right hand, please. Okay, carried. Continuation of water and sewer rate discussion. Mr. Wally.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Board. As a continuation from your discussion at your March meeting, we sent out a packet of information for you that addressed the three questions that the board had. Those three things were the 20-year, actually I think you said 15 to 20-year, but we had the 20-year available. So we went to 20-year history of rate increases, so you have that chart available. We have, we're also asked to provide what the average increase would have been over that 20 years. You have that, so that the average increase if broken out over that 20-year period would have been 3.4%. The average cost of living was discussed at the meeting, so as a note, we provided that from the Social Security Administration's website. And you can see over the same 20-year period, the average cost of living increase was 2.44%. And then you ask about the percentage of debt in the budget, and that percentage is 28.5%. What I will say is that includes all operating costs, and it includes the cash-funded capital projects. It does not include debt-funded capital projects, but if we fund a capital project with cash, then that is included.
If I may understand what you're saying that the budget that you considered had all that.
That's correct.
And the 28% was debt that was in that, which included operating and repairs and everything.
That is correct.
So that included that $200,000 that goes towards repairs?
Yes.
That you're able to keep in there each year for repairs?
That's correct. That does include the 200, which are, you're referring to the contingency fund at the 200.
Yes.
So it does include that 200 in the budget also. At the meeting, Novella and I took notes, and these are some of the pros that we've got for, that we took away from the meeting for each. Under as needed increases or only increasing as it becomes required, you know, the pros that we had is perception, you know, it and along with that, it does not build the budget, or there's not the perception that we're, you know, trying to build a larger budget. You know, you're only, you have the lowest rate possible until you absolutely need it. So those are some of the things you talked about under the advantages. Under incremental increases or going to, you know, an annual small increase, some of the things you talked about is that it reduces the impact of rate increases because you are slowly adding to your fee over multiple years, that it's less noticeable than one-time increases, and then it follows the cost of living. So those are some of the things that we picked up on that this board talked about at the last meeting. For cons for each of those, under the as needed, we talked about how it does, so those increases can be larger increases. And one of the things I'll point out in the chart that you received, there were 3 years that were back-to-back of large increases. Now, those were attributed to the wastewater expansion project and us having to get out of the or find another water source from the Black Creek Aquifer, and we built the plant, the water treatment plant, and the 16 wells that are associated with it and all the piping. So that those, you know, were attributable for those large increases. And then we have, it's hard for customers to adjust when you do have those large increases. And then there was impact from those large increases because people are complaining that you increased my water bill by 20%, as we talked about. For incremental increases, some of the cons are, again, you know, opposite from the as-needed advantages. There's a perception that you're building your budget. You have more money, so you spend more money, so you need more money. You also talked about the savings cannot cover future operational expenses. The operating budget is, we can't use what is in basically our savings account or our fund balance to fund operational expenses per our bond covenant. So there was some discussion that just adding that to the budget, it doesn't carry over to the next year. One of the things that I will say is, while that does not happen, one of the things that you can do with that as it adds to your fund balance is you can use that to fat cash fund projects so that you don't have to add new debt service, but that's the only way that it would carry over. It does add to the budget or to the rate each year, whether that's a 0.5% or 1% or whatever, it does add to the rate and to the budget each year. And then it does not eliminate the need for big increases. And on your chart that you have, you'll notice that we laid out a table that showed what it would have been had the 1% been enacted 20 years ago and it increased. You'll notice that it took out 3 or 4 of the initial increases, but when it got to that large 20% increase, it only reduced it a couple of percent. So when you have things like plant expansions or you have to adhere to regulatory requirements that require you to change your mode of operation or where you're getting your water source from or maybe how you're treating your water, then those are tough items to foresee or project in the future. So you do have those, a small incremental increase each year is not going to eliminate those large increases. So those are kind of some of the things we talked about. From there, I was going to turn it back over to the board for discussion. We'll be happy to answer any questions that we can. And Ms. Sabrina Adams-Gale, unfortunately, couldn't be here tonight, so Sabrina's filling in. But she probably knows as much about the history of the rate as anybody with the city, so I have full confidence in Sabrina.
Molly, from the public services side, your viewpoint version of things, would it be beneficial for you to leave as is or to look at putting in a 1% per year?
I think if we have to have something, if we are facing regulatory changes or there is a project that we really need, we are going to bring that forward and request it and try to look at our existing budget and move things around where we can to absorb that. And when we can't, that's where we're going to request rate increases, and we'll look at our model and see what that new debt does to us in the future. So I don't know that operational wise we have a preference for 1% versus not 1% or 0.5%. I mean, it's a small increase. So I don't know that there's, it doesn't, I don't know that the 1% having that in our budget, sure, it gives us more money available should something happen, mm-hmm. but we're not going to look to spend that anyway. So I don't know that there's it's a just in case. So I don't know that there's
I didn't know how eaten into sometimes that $200,000 gets into these days, and does that stay the same since you're saying that's by state rule that that's limited to that amount? So it's not something that, as costs go up, that's not necessarily going up too, or does that automatically go up also?
No, that is limited by the state. The contingency fund is limited by the state. But, and I don't have a how many times we've had to dip into that, but I would say most years we try not to unless we absolutely have to. And I don't know what we did last year. Last year would be one of the first years I could think of that we were really, we had a lot of problems. And this year's pretty tight because of
January, February.
Yes. Well, in the right at the beginning, in July of last year, I don't know if you remember, but we talked about a 30-foot deep sewer that collapsed over in Meadowbrook. And that was $200,000 in the first week of our new budget. So that was a pretty significant thing to absorb. But, you know, what we do is we rearrange our priorities, and we don't do things that if we need new equipment, then we wait till the second half of the budget year to see whether we can afford the new equipment or not. You know, we look for ways to try to extend our budget.
I know we've had issues with I&I before. Has I&I ever been, okay, we can't do this right now because kind of situations?
We recognize the importance of I&I, so we, you know, we do I&I efforts, and there are some things that, for example, one of our permit requirements is that we camera at least 10% of our lines each year. Well, as we're camering, that's also an I&I thing, because as we're camering, we can look for that I&I. So we can, what we try to do is double count. We'll focus on areas that we think have larger I&I, and then those are areas we go look at. So we get to count it toward our 10%, plus we're working on looking for I&I. We're working on inflow and infiltration activities. So we recognize the importance, and that's not something that we've just cut. But again, there's not a set, we spend $150,000 a year on inflow and infiltration. That is just part of our activities. Now, we do have capital projects for inflow and infiltration. And we have moved those around based on the availability for large fixes because it's contracted work. I think our last one was in the $700,000 to $900,000 range. And the first project we did was in the $1.3 million range. And those are really the two large projects we've gone out and actively fixed I&I, more than just, you know, finding broken cleanouts and finding collapsed sewers or places where, you know, the creek's getting in, or finding storm drains that are tied in through smoke testing. I mean, when we find those, we go ahead and through an operational activity, cut them loose. But the both of the projects, the engineers, the engineers calculated that we had taken somewhere around 400,000 gallons of I&I out of our system through those two projects.
400,000 per day?
Yes.
That's a significant amount of water.
It is. And where you can actually see that is I've charted since 2001 our average influent. And you can see that even with the growth that we've sustained since 2001, our influent has increased, but not significantly, which shows that, you know, all things remaining the same, the I&I that we're taking out of the system is being replaced by growth. And we're not, so we are doing a fairly good job of staying on top of our inflow and infiltration problems.
Any other questions?
Yeah, just clear my mind on something you said about surplus money. You can't carry that through the next year. Did I hear that right?
That's correct. The way that our bond covenants are written is if we have, you know, $200,000 left over in this budget, it does go to fund balance and it can be used. But per our bond covenants, we can't use our fund balance or our savings account to cover operational related expenses in the following year.
Well, what happens to the money if you've got excess? Say you got $100,000. What happens to that money?
What you can do, it goes into our fund balance, and what you can do is what we do is we use that money to cash fund projects or to upfront cash fund projects, and then when we issue debt, we use the debt to pay ourselves back. So there is an advantage to having that money available. And of course, you always need, just like at home, you always need a savings account if something happens. So if something were major were to happen, there is money available that we could go to, and we could appropriate that money.
Is that during the year? Just during that year you can appropriate, or if you don't use it, what happens to it?
It rolls over to the next year.
Oh, it does roll over. That was my question.
But a different
time. Yeah, I got you. But I'm not sure you didn't lose it, is what I was after.
No, you don't lose it. But the challenge is you could be sitting with a nice fund balance or a nice savings account, and because of our bond covenants, if we can't cover the operational cost with the rate we're receiving, we are required to do a rate increase,
right,
even though we have money in our savings account. That's the challenge. And that's really one of the biggest cons with incremental increases, is that, that money that is saved, you can use to, prolong, issuing debt because you can cash fund projects, but you can't use it for operational cost in regards to not having rate increases. So you can use it, but you can't just say, we're going to use this for salaries or for benefits or for, right, a jet truck or something like that, because those are operational expenses.
In the following year.
Right.
That's correct. Or in a future year.
Yes.
5 years away.
One of the interesting things I think to point out to this, and I understand what you're saying, you can't carry it forward, is if you do not have a rate increase, as we did not for many years, in which the chart kind of hides because we had some debt issues that came on that masked the fact that we had to have increases for operational. And the reason we did was because your operational budget, if it's fixed, you have a debt that's fixed, you have fixed costs, but those fixed costs for manpower and health and some other things go up every year approximately what the CPI is. So you don't sit there and freeze everybody's wages, and we try not to, and you can't freeze their health care. That's a part of the cost there. And so when those go up and you've kept this budget at a constant, the only place it can come out is in the discretionary area, which is like repairs. And you have your regular repairs, you have your preventive repairs, and you have your emergency repairs. And if you have enough emergency repairs, you don't have any preventive or regular repairs, or at least they get pushed aside. And if some of that preventive repairs, as we've seen in the past, is replacing pipe that when it goes costs much more than it would have if we had slipped it or had some other thing done to it. I would not advocate anything that would propose a large increase. However, if you look at it and you realize that while the budget is fixed, there is cost that increase that we have no control over. And if that budget is fixed, you're going to pay the debt, you're going to pay that promissory notes that you've got out to your employees and the health care and all that, which now has increased. It means it only comes out of those things, whether it's chemicals for the land app or it's making a repair at a pump station. Something's got to give. If you have a small increase, 0.5%, which on an $80 bill would be something like 40 cents a year, which is a lot less than the $5 they've been slapping on that utility bill for other things, then you have some mitigation so you can keep up with those repairs. Or we'll have what we did when they came in and explained why they wanted to go to the 22.4% that year, when they were explaining their model, and they said, and one of the things they had to do was readjust the rate so they could recover some of the lost repair capability. And if you remember, that's back when we were talking about slipping pipes, we were talking about INI, we were talking about getting other things done. So part of that is masked in there, that 22.4 and 25.4, majority was for the well, the new wells and the nano plant. But some of it was recovered, the erosion of repairs and stuff. Now, if you're on a fixed income, 40 cents might seem a lot, but most of the people on fixed income, retirees or otherwise, they're getting a cost of increase that's consistent with the CPI. They're going to get more than 40 cents. On $2,000, you're going to get about $40 that year. And you're saying 40 cents if it's half a percent, or 80 cents if it's a full percent, you're putting back in that budget that got eroded because the cost of chemicals for the land app or the water treatment plant went up, or because you had to pay your employees enough to keep them because their COLA increased, or you had to pay the health care. So not to say that we got to do an increase, but it does, as you can see, before we had a significant debt to take on. And remember, out of that $80, about $22, $23 of that is that debt. You're going to, if we had had a 1% increase, we would have eliminated those that were listed there for 2003 and 5 and 6. And probably we would have been able to do out of cash some of the minor repairs that were capital improvement plans, because that's how we fund that. So it wouldn't necessarily at 80 cents at 1% times 17,000 accounts. It's not a lot of money to keep up with inflation. Now, we can wait, and you can do a 5 or 10 or 15%, just like they did for the facility charge when all the contractors yelled because they went from $1,600 to $4,800. And I just don't know that we need to put the staff, who's always going to tell us they're going to do whatever they get. But we know what happens when you don't keep up the pump stations, you don't keep up the pipes, and they get crushed or they fail because they're clay and they're downtown. But there is some benefit, and it's not that you're going to earn savings that you're going to roll over into the following years. You'll get savings because you'll be able to not have to take debt out to do minor capital improvement programs. You'll be able to keep up with the regular maintenance and the preventive maintenance. And of course, emergency maintenance will always be taken care of. Just something else to think about in the presentation here.
Let me say something. I think it's our responsibility to look at the rates every year, but I don't think we need to think about raising them every year if it's not needed. I do think we need to look at them every year. I think that's part of what we're on the committee for. But I question whether we need to think about raising them every year. I think we just need to check them.
I have a question on how we define need to.
Yeah.
Because while you've stated, your folks will try to push aside, realign, reprioritize to make the budget work. You know, we're all familiar with trying to make budgets work, you know, whether it's our personal budget or whatever kind of budget it is. And when you tell them, well, do you need to do it? Okay, how exactly are we measuring need? Because if they're pushing something aside, saying, yeah, we can reprioritize and push this aside and try to do it next year instead of being $15,000 to fix it, and it fails completely, and now it's going to cost $250,000. Did you save anything by doing that? And the answer is no. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, do they need to? But how are we defining need?
Right.
And that gets to be important.
Yeah.
So, if that 1% ends up saving us money by them not having to reprioritize, push back, push aside, and try to reschedule stuff, which doesn't necessarily help us, then it's.
But you got the flip side of that. Are you just going to keep growing the budget?
But you don't get to grow the budget.
You do if nothing happens. I'm not saying nothing's ever going to happen. I'm just saying, how can you justify saying to people, we're just going to raise your rates because we think we need to?
And my answer to that, and again, I've been on both sides of this issue, so I don't want to be ugly about this, but my answer to somebody who would say that is, if the cost of things are going up for you, they're going up for the staff in their operations on things that they cannot avoid buying. Chemicals for the nano plant, things out at the land.
Electricity,
gasoline, you know. So my answer to your first question is, how do you justify raising the rates every year? It's if I raise it every year by a minimum amount, just hardly any at all, and can avoid expensive repairs and avoid repairs that require debt service, then you're paying 5, 10, there was a point they were paying 15% for debt here, then you know that's how you justify that. And I understand, maybe the whole board will say there's no way to make the recommendation, but the alternative, the middle ground, is to say we look at them every year and then we try to make a justification at the 5-year point when we haven't had any rates increases and say we need to raise the rate at that time. And I'll guarantee you the argument then will be the same one that would be presented now. Why do you need to raise the rate? Find savings, delay this, do that. But you'd had 5 years of the CPI going up. I mean, even when Social Security didn't pay me because the CPI was less than 1% for 2 years, the third year they made it up. They picked up all that and said, hey, listen, we didn't pay you that year, but we realized it went up 0.8%, so we're just going to roll that into the 2% for this year. So you pay me now or pay me later. And that's, again, I know the board is inclined, I'm always inclined to keep the rates low as possible. But on the other hand, if you're not keeping up with inflation, then you're eroding something. And if you're eroding it, that means either work doesn't get done, or when it does get done, you got a big ticket item that requires you to pay on a debt service to get the money to do it. And that's when you end up with a much bigger. And I think people don't like having a 15 or 10 or 8% increase in their water rate or sewer rate.
Oh, I don't think they should do that. As it should be as long in between increases if they're needed, but I seriously don't think you need to do it every year.
Yeah, that's
their costs go up just like everybody else's costs go up. I mean, they pay for electricity.
Everybody else looks to economize just like everybody's house and everybody's government does too.
What would you think would be a reasonable time to look at it to say?
And that's what I'm saying. We should look at it every year, but do we need to raise it every year?
So when we get to the point that we have a 3 or 4%, then we need to do it. See, part of the problem I have reconciling that in my mind is this. We say we don't need a rate increase last year, and we didn't get one, but there was a increase in the CPI that was moderate for this time, for this period of history. And so this year we're saying we really don't need it. So you add last year and this year, next year, where I might advocate a 1%, there's really probably a 4 or 5% erosion to the discretionary funds that aren't fixed because the other has gone up. So the erosion will be there. We just won't have seen it as much, because until that pipe fails or that pump has a problem or the alarm system no longer works, it doesn't seem important. I'm not saying I don't agree with you. I just don't know how you find the point that trips and says this is the time we need to raise the rate, when you could raise the rate, I don't know, 0.25%, 0.5%, 1%. I'll let anybody pick a percentage, but something to mitigate. And when you look at the CPI over the 20 years that Wally presented, it was what, 3.4% or 2.8%?
Yeah, I mean, it was 2.4.
So 2.4%.
I've got a question about what are we paying for? 6,000 gallons of water a month. We're paying $80.60?
Yes, sir.
That's water and sewer.
That's water and sewer.
Pardon?
That's water and sewer.
Water and sewer.
And we picked.
I understand that, but so in a couple more years, we're gonna be paying $100. And then you say, I'm not as eloquent as some people are, nor am I prepared to speak on this in a length. I just got more questions than answers, but that seems like an awful lot of water, unless you're in the commercial business or something.
But Ray and Mike had helped me with that, and, but we picked.
Let me try to finish, because my chain of thought ain't good. I wish I had a water bill in front of me right now. But we are paying, only one I can remember now, is for stormwater runoff. We're paying so much money.
That's separate from this.
Pardon?
That's totally separate from this.
Is it?
Yes.
Yes, that is not us. We have nothing to do with the stormwater. We have nothing to do with the trash collection and the trash fee.
But it's on my water bill.
No, it is on your utility bill, which has our water, our sewer, our trash, and our stormwater.
I said I wasn't we were prepared for.
We only do so, we only do water and sewer.
I come back to $80 then. What are we spending $80 on? And then you say 40 cents out of a dollar isn't that bad. Isn't that bad for whom? It's really devastating for some people. $40? I mean, 40 cents out of a dollar?
No.
40 cents more. So instead of being $80.60, it would be $81. A 40 cent increase.
Yeah. But I remember when this thing was down around $47, well, there it is on there. And, because I've talked about this, I've advocated about this for years since I've been on here, about, every little thing comes along, we put on a water bill. And one of them is, you don't see it on there now, but it's probably still there somewhere. The $15.70 we paid for the
land
application.
That's included in the $80.
I understand that. How come I can't see it on my water bill?
Because they changed the way they build.
I think that was done back in
that's real good, that's
9.
Real good.
Yeah, it was because I always remember that was a big thing that when that was paid off, that
it
would come off the bill.
And once
a lot of people remember that.
And once that was paid for, that tax was supposed to go away. But it's the same old thing. Once a tax, always a tax. It just come up with a different name. So, looks like every little thing that comes along that's easy to get over with, put it on the water bill. Man, there's some people really, really can't afford the $80. And we're talking about going up higher. A water bill used to be maybe $8, $10, $12. Hey, look where it's gone. How far much further is it going to go? And as far as that 40 cents out of a dollar, it's a lot of people, we said fixed income. Fixed income out of what? Suppose I'm only making, I'm going to say $100 a year. $40 out of that $100?
No.
We should, I think we should, like the Vice President said, look at it each year and then decide whether we need to increase it. And when we look at it, have everything on our so we can see it. Because when people ask me, I can't tell them. Have everything on there so we can see it. And when you send out the utility bills, have it on there for everybody to see. I wish I could be more eloquent on that. That's the best I can do.
You did just fine.
Well, William, you asked a question there, and let me give you the answer, because we had somebody give that presentation once. That $15 for the land app, that was paid off. What happened was, back in 2007, they took out the first part of the $20 million that they needed for the water treatment plant, the nano water treatment plant.
Yeah,
and the reason that it's not, you're not paying the $15 for the land app today, you're paying $22.40 or about $22.50 for debt that includes a $20 million nano water treatment system, 16 water towers that were new because we had to go out of the thing. So what they did was they paid off one debt, but because that debt was gone, they had room to take on other debt, and they needed that debt for that expanded water treatment plant and for the water towers. Now, when I said 40 cents earlier, that to answer your question there, that's 40 cents, period. That's not 40 cents per dollar. And if somebody's getting $2,000 a year on a fixed income, which is not very much in this city, a 2% cost of increase on that is $40. So you're looking at 40 cents out of $40 in any given year. Now, that doesn't mean you should raise it. I'm just giving you some, it's not 40 cents per dollar on your bill. And I pay the minimum for my house where I live, which the total bill is $70.07, but my water and sewer is $50, because the rest of that is for the tipping fee and the stormwater fee, and there's a third one. So, yes, you make good points, William.
Somewhere along the line of what you just said about the, we paid off one and started another one. Mm-hmm. I'm on the water and sewer advisory board. I didn't know all that. If I didn't know it, who does know it? There's people who live in on Social Security getting $700 to $800 a month. They don't care. The only thing they know is they got to cut up back someplace else, and maybe on their medicine. I just did that to be dramatic, I guess, but they got to cut back on something somewhere. Food. Not saying we don't need it, but don't be asking for something that we are. Taxes going to come along anyway. I don't see why we should be asking for it before it comes along.
Except this is not a tax, and it's based on how much water
I don't care what you
we
call
use.
It's money less out of my pocket.
Yeah, and if you're wanting to get your 2,000, 4,000, 6,000, whatever it is, gallons per month, you want it to come to you safely and clean, and you want it to be leaving your house and going through the sewer system properly as opposed to breaking free, surfacing, and making a mess someplace. And they have to pay for that. They have to be able to use the chemicals. They have to transport it. They're paying for pumps, the electricity associated with those pumps, and their costs aren't going. And so they're having to look at, okay, if we're not raising our, if they're on that fixed income now and their costs are going up, where can they cut their expenses? And it's like home maintenance. If you can't get your refrigerator fixed and you're keeping it together with duct tape and baling twine, and all of a sudden it goes out, being able to regularly maintain something might make it last longer and not have such a big repair bill as when it totally goes. And part of it is, if they're able to raise it a little bit, they're able to pay for some of those repairs better.
When you say, when you're speaking to, who is this third party there?
She's talking Wally's about the utility.
Wally gets a bill. It's Wally's bill, and it's a humdinger.
If I can add to that.
I wish Wally would be. What's that term? The politician used being more open in government.
Transparent.
Transparent.
You need to be more transparent, Wally.
You need more transparent as possible.
We're going to start seeing right through you.
Yes. What I will say is, you know, for the board's benefit and the viewing, we're not here asking for a rate increase. This is a strictly your philosophy as a board that you would like or would not like to be carried forward to council. And, of course, we're not talking about this budget year. Before this could even go into effect, we would be talking about another budget year away. So it's, I mean, this is a philosophy, that's the purpose of the discussion. Certainly, we picked 6,000 gallons because not only has the rate changed over time, the base, the amount of water included in the base rate has changed, having a base rate has changed, the tiered, having tiered, a tiered structure where you're charged based on the additional amount of water, it was has changed and been added. I think a lot of that happened in the 2007-08 time frame. In addition to your $15 or $18, whatever it was for the land app, I don't know if you remember, but there used to be a dollar that was added for an I&I fee. And it was broken out separately on the bill.
I didn't know enough about that to go into our
So part of, and that was for, you know, inflow and infiltration efforts. And when the bill was consolidated, that was one of the things that was rolled in. But, you know, that dollar had a percentage increase at some point in the past. If I had to guess, I would say that was probably in the 2005 or 2006 time frame. But so, you know, that was a dollar that was added for I&I. And it, you know, I think when things are added, it is easier when you add them in and say, this is going, you know, like a menu, this is going for this item. Problem is when that item's done, there is typically something behind it that you have to do. So you're just deleting an item and
adding
another one. And what would happen is, I mean, if we included everything that goes into our rate calculation, you might have a 3-page water bill. But it's a...
On the other hand, do you think it's fair to just say, here's the bill, pay it, and not give any explanation?
No, but that's why we have the budget is available on the website. We have, I mean, we do have everything available. It's not a... But, I mean, it's hard to give a line item menu. And, you know, I wasn't a proponent of changing it when it was there because I wasn't, I mean, I was here, but not in this capacity.
Could a simplified chart maybe get put on saying, of your repair, of your water and sewer bill, this much goes towards X, this much goes towards, this percentage is Y, this percentage is X, this percentage is Z, and just have it broken up like that?
Or we could do, we make it look at some sort of, educational component. We do mail outs in the water bill all the time. We could certainly
but that's include the thing. Something. What percentage have you got anymore of people who don't even get a printed water bill?
I don't know. Do you know what the percentage is, Sabrina?
That don't get a printed?
Yeah.
I don't know the exact percentage. I do know that we have a lot of people that are receiving the e-bills, but there are, you can opt for both. So we have a lot of people to get the e-bill as well as the printed. But if you do get the e-bill, you still have access to the insert.
You do, but you don't. You're not going to open it. You're not going to look at it. You know.
Okay, 6,000 gallons. That's the base rate.
No,
2,000 is the base rate. We picked 6,000. You may can help me on this, but that's.
Yeah, I picked it because it's the national average that we use generally when we talk with customers about, you know, where we can expect their rate to be. We estimate that each person in the home uses about 2,000 gallons. So in a 3-person home, you're looking at around 6,000. That's our average, so that helps us gauge if someone's high or low. But that's just the national average, so that's the number that we use normally when we're looking at rates.
Well, in a nutshell, I'll be through. Ask for a tax when we need one.
Which gets back to that definition of need again, so.
Jim, if I can ask, is it possible at a future meeting that the staff provide us with what data is available to tell us what their fixed cost increase was? In other words, in the budget that he has for water and sewer, there's a debt. We know that doesn't change. That's kind of that 28%. We know there's like a discretionary for repair, but we know there are things that they have to do and find out if that is increasing annually or if that is not. And I would not be an advocate of going back and doing 20 years, but if we could get that for this year or maybe if it's
2 years,
you know, and then we can have this discussion again with a little bit more information that says, you know what, that really isn't a significant increase and they can do without that I&I or whatever they didn't do because they had in the first quarter a major emergency repair. Or we can look at and say, you know, that ate a lot of the discretionary repair stuff and maybe we need to consider recommending a rate increase. Is that type of information that would be useful, Joe?
But you know, people, you know, especially people on low income, they expected their electricity bill to be high and the water bill to be down here. They didn't expect it to meet at the top like it is now. And that's what's happening. And sometime it might go over. And these people aren't really making any money. I know people living in, you know, 2 and 3 little room houses, not bedroom houses, room houses. They're paying more for utilities than the houses were. But they have to survive with that. But they can't survive you keep on adding to this and adding to that. I think I was through. I am through.
Well, and I think, you know, from a staff perspective, that is something that, you know, unfortunately we do battle. There is a perception that water should be free or very low cost. And, you know, our water comes from a minimum of 200 feet out of the ground. And then it's got to be pumped through approximately 300 miles of pipe to get to all the houses. And on top of that, we have to treat it to meet the, you know, national requirements. And then we have to dispose of it through another 300 miles of pipe at a 7,200 acre facility. I mean, so unfortunately, I wish I could provide it to everybody for free, you know, but that is, you're correct. That is one of the perceptions that we battle is, you know, there's a perception that water should be free. Or very low cost.
And it's not getting less expensive.
That's correct.
Treatment's getting more and more.
Of course, you know, you look at, I do have to laugh every time I see somebody go into a gas station buy a $1.50 bottle of water. We'll sell you $100,000.
They'll start bottling their own water, right? You're going to have Jacksonville's own and start selling it by the case?
Paula, can you get some of that information that Tom asked about?
We can come up with something.
Okay.
And if that's the case, then I move that we table this conversation for 6 months. And if he comes up with that information and we start this conversation 6 months, that will be far enough that he can gather some and we can have the conversation before the next budget if it turns out that we should.
Put that into a motion. Okay. Do we have a second for it?
Second.
All in favor? You're not in favor, sir?
I don't know what you're
saying. To come back and discuss it again in 6 months.
Okay.
You okay with that?
Yeah.
All right, raise your hand.
Paulie, do you have anything else for us?
I don't. I was just going to let you know the we did have that low pressure come through.
That's
and our rain gauges were all over the map. We had some that had as little as 3 inches in them. We had several in the 6.5 to 6.75 range, and we had one in the 9-inch range. You know, it came as waves across the city, so it just depended where we were. I will let you know that at the Land App site, we fared very, very well. Of course, we had several days of very high influent because of all the rain. Our South Lagoon was valved off, and we added just short of a half a foot to that. I think we added around 4/10 of a foot to the South Lagoon, which if you're not feeding any, that pretty much verifies that it was about 6 inches of rain, give or take. We are not close to freeboard. I want to say that we're somewhere around the 10-foot mark in the South Lagoon. I think freeboard's at 14 and a half or so. And then we were around 8.9, I think, in the east and west, and 11.5 freeboard in the east and west. So there we go. So, well, this was after the event.
No, okay.
We also had 6 stations that went into high alarm, but, you know, admittedly, again, our alarms are set fairly low to give us response time should we need it. And we did not have any incidents, so we had no sewer overflows or anything like that. So, all in all, we fared the storm pretty well.
How did Barnes Street do after all that project?
Barnes Street did very well. We didn't have to, we checked it. We didn't have any overflows, and we didn't have to put any pumps there.
Oh, good.
So it did very well. And Barnes Street is paved. So that project's completed, if anybody hasn't been by there.
Let me ask you one question here about this under utility customer information. It says there's 0 usage accounts,
yes.
And they're running, you know, a little over 1,000. Are they being charged a flat for 2,000 gallon?
That's correct. They're paying the base rate.
They're not having to. Okay.
So that would be You know, like Mr. Nichols shared several times that he has rentals. If he has a house that's vacant for 2 months and he keeps the water on, then he gets charged the base rate even though there's zero usage at that residence. So, and this was added as a request from Mr. Thomas. He was consistently looking for this information, so we figured this would be good information to also supply. And I think Mr. Thomas was loosely equivalent it to possible vacancies.
It's not possible. You can't live there without using any water. I mean, it's got to be vacant if you're using zero usage. And you see, in addition, there's probably another 1,500 that aren't turned on.
Yeah.
So that's what you're looking at, is about 2,500 empty homes out of 19,000 meters. So that's just what I'm, you know, you're looking at.
The health department won't let you live in a house without water, will it?
I think it's
if they knew, but I mean, the people do department. It. I mean, it's not like it's not ever done, but I'm just saying if they've got the water turned on, they'll use it if they're there.
Sabrina, do they still in the water department, if they do a shut off after so many days, they'll notify the health department?
No, we do in some cases. Of course, if we turn a, you know, if it's a business.
No residential.
If it's a restaurant, it's the health department. If it's if we feel like for a residential, if it's a senior citizen or if there's children involved, if we know if the neighbor calls and says these people have kids out and we have water, we will collect code enforcement. For a normal customer.
I mean, they don't have to have water if they don't want to, but if they have a senior citizen or a child involved, they have to have water. One other question on that, sure. Was with what I just asked. Are they having to pay the $5 for the runoff stormwater fee? Is that also sure. Being on the same bill? How about your trash? If they got two trash cans still there, they're going to have to pay for them too.
Yep. Well, if they've got the trash cans there, they have to pay for them. But they can have trash service if it's vacant, and they can if water's in a renter's name, they turn it off. The billing department actually sends the stormwater fee to the property owner. Correct.
If it's residential. No, if it's residential and it's a rental and it's vacant, the stormwater fee stays, and so will the trash, unless specifically the owner or whoever is in charge of the property requests. And we don't really advertise that, so it's not too often only if they call and really complain about the bill. A lot of the zero usage accounts, or a fair amount of them, are from apartments. We have several large apartment complexes that are now on an auto reinstate, which means that as soon as the tenant moves in, it automatically reinstates back to the property manager. And so they, quite a few of those will not have a stormwater or individual sanitation because they have the dumpsters and they're paying the stormwater fee at the property manager level on the whole complex. So not all of those will have those fees, but if they're just standard residential rentals, they will still have them.
Jim, I could answer that from personal experience. I had a renter that moved out, and they turned off the water, and they had gotten two trash cans. And because I didn't know they had two trash cans, I had to pay for two trash cans for 2 months. And then I said, why is my bill different here than over here? And they said, because you have two trash cans. So I turned one in, and that came off. Now, at the same time, because they turned the water off, and I was not charged for the stormwater until I when they turn it off, and if I don't turn it back on for myself, then I don't pay anything for the trash, for the stormwater, or any of that. But if I keep it on, in other words, they move out, they turn it off, and I go in and turn it on so I can clean and I can do other things, then I pay trash and stormwater and all that. So if the account is zero, nobody is paying for any of those things.
Right. On a commercial property, just to add to that, on the residential properties, we don't. If you close out your account or the renter closes out the account, there's not an active account at all, and there's no charges, we don't track down the property owner. But on the commercial accounts, we do look for those as we're kind of billing commercial accounts, and we do go back and bill the property owner if they have requested that it would be billed to the tenant. Commercial accounts are a little bit easier to keep track of, and the stormwater, you know, they have a lot more impervious surface area, but for the rentals, and I think because we do have so many turnoffs and turnoffs and turn-ons, it's, we don't really have a way to keep track of all of those property owners.
I will give them a kudo on one thing. I had a tenant who did not pay their bill, and the water was turned off, and the tenant was still living there, and I did not know they weren't paying their bill. And the people down the corridor here called me to let me know that I had a property with the water turned off, and they knew I was the property owner. And so I went down to see the tenant and get the water turned back on. But that, again, they were good enough to let me know that this person with children had, you know, done a number of things that caused the water to be turned off, and they didn't let me go ignorant. So kudos for that, because that took extra effort.
Any further questions for Mr. Director Dimer? Okay, moving along here. Old business. Does anybody have any more old business than what we've already had?
Well, before we get too far, I have one quick question on the grease report. The number of grease establishments without grease traps went down, and one with internal grease traps went up by one. If I take it, somebody that didn't have one now has one?
I don't know. I'll ask Percy. He's not here today.
Okay.
But it so could.
That's what he
okay,
told
there
me.
You go.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Yes, that's what happened.
Okay.
So they added
thank you.
One.
Okay.
Are those the same 41? In February and March for paperwork violations, they all, they say people.
22 or repeat.
Good.
Yep, that's correct. 22 or repeat.
Okay. Any other questions? All right, new business. Any new business? You have here on your report the planning board and permitting updates. Planning board in April issued 198 permits. There's a site plan been turned in at 4200 Weston Boulevard for a Walmart neighborhood market and gas station. At 2301 Lejeune Boulevard, Highway 24, Abra's, I guess it is, Auto Body and Glass is expanding a little bit out there. And one, I don't know where this is going to go at, but 139 Moose Haven Road, they're going to put a Holiday Inn Express there. That's the road, the old State Employees Bank, the back of it. Should be back there. I don't know where they're going to put it in there. I have not been out that way lately. Okay. On Wassa's report, I did not attend the meeting last month due to the banquet dinner that the city had. I had to attend that, and they canceled their meeting for this month. Most of their people that put on the stuff there at the advisory is in Greensboro to a meeting up there, so they didn't have enough people to have a meeting out there. Planning board met Monday. We changed a couple rezoning requests out here off of Gum Branch Road. If you're familiar there with, was it what was that bar out there, do you know?
Dunkfield,
okay. That, and there's a tent shopping all next door to it. They wanted it to be amended from residential to commercial corridor. And we approved that. Let me see what else. They took off here, if anybody wants to see it, down by where Hounslow Pines, that the county requested that. There's that right there, all this over in here has all been taken out of the ETJ for the city and turned back over to the county. So there's something like 20 some parcels down there by, you know, where the Harley Davidson shop's at, that road right there.
Just a second. Isn't that development across the road from the Harley-Davidson, isn't that city water?
I don't believe so, because I don't believe we've
got
water.
It's on the road out there.
I don't think we have water that far out.
Do we have sewer there?
No, I don't believe so. I know we have sewer out to behind what was Mr. George Howard's property. He has a small sewer lift station for that shopping center that was La Mirage is in there. There's a couple other right in that area. We have sewer out that far. And then further up, I guess that's Blue Creek School Road. Further up that road, we also have sewer. City has sewer that serves the Springdale Acres subdivision.
Okay.
And that was the joint between Omwassa and the city.
Okay.
But we don't have water. We don't have water on that side of the bypass, as far as I know.
No. Okay. For some reason, I thought that that one time they had wanted to be annexed in or something, that development out there. Past Harley, the one that's the Onslow Pines Road.
South Creek or something. Like
there was there was one that came in and requested, you know, last several years, I think Fieldstone, because they had a lot of problems, but we don't have anything close to
All right.
But they had a lot of problems with septic, I believe.
Sorry, Jim, go ahead.
Planning board meeting that was held this Monday. We had a continuation on what I'd started. We had a joint session with the Community Development Advisory Committee, and it was on New River Shopping Center. New River had gone into, as you probably know, bankruptcy. Nobody bid on it. So the bank took it back over for $11.5 million. There's over 700 units there. There's 18 stores in the shopping center that are vacant. They're going to try, we saw some photos and all of, up in Raleigh, where City of Raleigh has taken and redid something similar to New River, updated, built some new buildings, apartments and all. And they got money from different grants, the state and federal and all like this. And the city's going to be looking at something like that over there. Putting in some more, I think Clyde Irwin School showed that they were putting another extension on the building. Jack Hammett has been redone, ball fields and all like that. They showed us some pictures of some of the houses over there looked real, or the apartments looked real nice. The people that own those had, you know, new siding and painted and all like that. And it showed some others with trash and everything in the front yard and siding hanging off of it and all like that. This is what they're going to try and, I mean, it's not going to be done tomorrow or nothing. It's going to take some time to do it. But they want to start picking it up there, make it look a lot better. Have you heard anything on that?
We had a workshop on it and heard kind of the same same thing.
What are they going to do about the old paper window?
That's 2 months. I think it was 2 months ago that we voted on putting homeless shelter and the soup kitchen and everything. They're going to close up the one downtown and open it up there.
That's a good deal.
They're going to have 40, I believe it was 40 beds in there for the homeless.
I forget what I thought.
And the soup kitchen.
I did want to clarify one thing. I think what went into bankruptcy was actually the apartments and not the shopping center.
Not the shopping center.
Oh, no, not the shopping center.
It was town center apartments.
700 and some apartments were in the bankruptcy.
Different.
But I would just say they brought up the fact that there was only, that there was still 18 business, and they would like to see, you know, a couple restaurants go in there, steakhouse or something like that, like they used to have. There's, what is it, Planet Fitness, is that the one over there? There's, was it Dollar General? I haven't been over there in so long.
There's the Dollar General, there's City Trend, there's the college at the end.
I mean the college,
There's a pizza place, there's the Chinese restaurant, there's the thrift store.
You must go over there quite a bit.
I buy it every day.
I haven't been over there in a long time.
Yeah, that's right around the corner.
Yeah, but this is what the city's going to try and do, is get some help from different but grants. And
that big central part, I think the county moved all of their stuff out of there when they moved out to Burton, right?
No, not completely. They're rebuilding. It's going to take a couple of years, but they're going to add a whole big thing over there at the old hospital. The big social social services building is going to be abandoned, and they're going to move it all over there.
But they'll be out of New River Shopping Center.
They'll be out of New River.
Yeah, and
well,
Peebles
out of the shopping
too.
Center itself, I think they probably moved in, but not all of them went out too. They moved a lot of it back over here by the old hospital.
Oh, okay.
And then they're going to build some more. You know, they had this lot over here behind the post office.
Yeah.
Well, from what I understand, it's up for sale. And they're not going to put anything there.
How come they were allowed to get away with not putting in a sidewalk when everybody else has to?
Which one is that?
You know where the post office is, and you go across the post office and it has a sidewalk, and right when you get to the county property, there's no sidewalk.
Because they haven't developed yet.
If they built on it, they have to.
That's correct. They actually came in with a proposed plan at one point.
We approved the plan.
It was going to be a parking lot for the court.
It was going to be the county complex.
It was going to
be the administrative office. Yes. That's what we approved.
Because there's no sidewalk there.
Yes.
Nothing was built.
The proposed plan showed sidewalk on West Bay Shore and on Johnson Boulevard.
Mm-hmm.
So if and when that property is developed, then they will have to put
a
sidewalk.
That's what I wondered, because they put that pond so close to the street.
They were trying to get a jump on new regulations as far as stormwater went, so they just did that anyway.
Yeah, because
they saved the money.
Yeah.
So when it develops out, they will be required to put it in.
So now they're looking at selling it. Okay. Now they're looking at selling it.
That's all I have on those reports. Anybody have any other questions they'd like to bring up? If not, entertain a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion.
Okay, we have a motion. We have a second.
Perfect.
We have a second. All in favor of adjourning?
Right here.
Right.
Got it.